Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents A Sudden Change of Heart by Barbara Taylor Bradford. Prologue, Summer 1972. The girl was tall for seven, dark-haired, with vividly blue eyes and an alert, intelligent face. Thin, almost wiry, there was a tomboy look about her, perhaps because of her slimness, short hair, restless energy, and the clothes she wore. They were her favorite pieces of clothing, her uniform, her grandmother said. But she loved her blue jeans, white t-shirt, and white sneakers. The sneakers and t-shirt were her two vanities. They must always be pristine, whiter than white, and so they were constantly in the washing machine or being replaced. The seven-year-old's name was Laura Valiant, and she was dressed thus this morning as she slipped out of the white clabbered colonial house on the hill and raced across the lawns and down to the river flowing through her grandparents' property. This was a long, wide, green valley surrounded by soaring hills near Kent, a small rural town in the northwestern corner of Connecticut. Her grandparents had come to America from Wales many years ago in the 1920s, and after they had bought this wonderful verdant valley, they had given it the Welsh name of Rhondda Fach, the little Rhondda it meant. Once she reached the river, Laura turned and made for the dry stone wall and the copse where giant oaks and maples grew in great abundance. Years before, when he was a boy, her father and his siblings had built a treehouse in one of the giant oaks. It had remained intact, and it was Laura's favorite spot, just as it had been for other young Valiants before her. Reaching the rope ladder, which dropped down from the fork in the branches where the treehouse was built, Laura scrambled up and inside the leafy lair. It was 6 o'clock on a bright and shining July day, and she loved the feeling of being alone. She loved everything about Rhondda Fach, much preferred it to New York, where she lived with her parents and her brother Dylan. Imperceptibly, Laura's young face changed as she thought of her parents. Richard, her father, was a well-known composer and conductor. He was usually traveling somewhere to conduct a symphony orchestra, and her mother invariably went along with him. "Those two are inseparable," her grandmother would say, but she said it with a sniff and in such a way it sounded like a criticism. Laura understood that it was. And it was also true that they were hardly ever around. When her mother Maggie wasn't traveling, she was painting her famous flower pictures in her studio on the west side. "She gets good money for them," Grandfather Owen kept saying, making excuses for her mother because he was always kind to everyone. And so it was that Laura and her brother Dylan, 3 years younger than she, were frequently left in the care of their grandparents. She loved being with them. They were her favorites, really. She loved her parents, and she was quite close to her father when he was there to be close, too. But most of the time, her mother was distant, remote. Laura thought of the rope ladder that dangled down to the ground, and she moved toward it, intending to pull it up the way her father had shown her. Then changed her mind. Nobody was going to invade her private lair. It was far too early. Besides, Dylan was too young at four to get much farther than the first few rope rungs, and her friend Claire, who was visiting, was afraid to climb up in case she fell. Claire was scared of other things, even though she was 12 and much more grown up than Laura. She was small, dainty, fragile, and very pretty, with deep green eyes and red hair. A Dresden doll, Grandma Megan called her, and it was the most perfect description. Laura loved Claire. They were the best of best friends, even though they were so different. "Chalk and cheese," Grandpa Owen said about them. Laura didn't know if she was the chalk or the cheese. In certain ways, she was in awe of Claire. After all, Claire was 5 years older and knew so much more than she did. Laura took her diary from its secret hiding place and began to write her private thoughts, which she did every day. Soon it began to grow warmer inside the treehouse, and several times Laura found her eyelids drooping. Finally, she put down her diary and pen, rested her head against the wall, and although she tried hard to stay awake, she began to doze. Laura was not sure how long she had been asleep, but quite suddenly she opened her eyes and sat up with a start. A moment before, she had heard screams coming from somewhere in the distance. Had she been dreaming? Then she heard it again, a faint scream and an even fainter voice calling, "Help! Help!" It had not been a dream. Someone was in trouble. Crawling as fast as she could, Laura backed out of the treehouse, bottom first, dangled over the edge until she found her footing on the rope ladder, and climbed down swiftly. The cries were increasingly faint, and then they stopped altogether. They had emanated from that part of the river which was wide and deep, beyond the dry stone wall near the meadow where all kinds of wildflowers grew. Sensing it was Claire calling for help, Laura ran at breakneck speed, her long legs flying over the grass. Coming to a stop when she saw the flower basket, Laura pulled off her sneakers and jeans and scrambled down the muddy bank just as Claire's pale face bobbed up above the surface of the water. "I'm here, Claire!" Laura shouted, dived in, and swam toward her friend. Claire's head went under again, and Laura took several gulps of air and dived once more. At once, she spotted Claire floating underwater. Swimming to her, Laura grabbed her under the arms and swam them both up to the surface as best she could. But then, when she started swimming them both toward the bank, Laura was pulled back along with Claire, who was clinging to her. "It's my foot!" Claire managed to splutter. "It's caught on something!" Terror etched her stark white face, and her eyes were wide with panic. Laura glanced around frantically, wondering what to do. She had to get Claire's foot free from whatever was holding it underwater, yet she could not let go of Claire, who would sink if she released her. Laura spotted the branch of a tree a short distance away from them. It was a large limb, half on the bank, half in the water, and she was smart enough to know it was probably too heavy for her to lift. But she decided she must attempt to swivel the part that was in the water toward them. If she was successful, Claire could hang on to it, use it as a raft. Staring at Claire, she said, "I'm going to get that branch over there so you can hang on to it. Then I'll get your foot loose. When I let go of you, start flapping your arms in the water and keep moving your free leg. You'll stay afloat. You'll be okay." Claire was unable to speak. She was terrified. Laura let go of her, shouted, "Flap your arms. Move your leg." Once Claire started to do this, Laura swam upstream in the direction of the branch. After a bit of tugging and pulling, it came away from the bank and flopped into the river with a splash. Dragging it with one hand, Laura struck out, heading for Claire. Although she had gone under several times, Claire had kept on moving her arms and leg in the water and had managed to hold her own. As soon as Laura pulled the branch nearer to her, Claire grabbed for it and hung on tightly. So did Laura, who needed to catch her breath and rest for a few minutes. When she had recouped, she dived underwater and was frightened when she saw that Claire's foot was caught in a roll of wire netting, part of which had unraveled. Claire's sneaker was wedged in, entangled with the loose part of the wire netting. Laura attempted to free her foot, but she could not, nor could she get the sneaker off, try though she did. She floated up to the surface, took several big gulps of air, and rested her arm on the branch. Peering into Claire's worried face, she said, "I'll have to go and get Tom, the caretaker, to help me." "Don't leave me," Claire whispered tremulously, sounding more nervous than ever. "I have to. Just don't let go of that branch." After hauling herself up out of the water, Laura pulled on her jeans and sneakers and set off across the meadow. She ran at a good speed, heading for the farm's compound of buildings in search of Tom. When he was nowhere to be found, and knowing there was no time to waste, Laura dashed into his tool shed, found a pair of garden scissors, and headed back to the river. After undressing once more, Laura dived into the river and swam over to Claire, who still clung to the tree branch, looking scared. Showing Claire the garden scissors, Laura explained, "I can't find Tom. I'm going down. I'm going to cut your sneaker off." Claire nodded. She was shaking uncontrollably, and goosebumps had sprung up all over her body from being too long in the cold river. Laura dived down and managed to maneuver her right hand and the garden scissors underneath the wire netting. Her first attempt to release the trapped foot was to cut up the front of the laces. She succeeded, but Claire's foot would not come out of the sneaker. After struggling for a few seconds longer, Laura had to rise to the surface to breathe in air. Within minutes, she dived down again. This time, she cut each side of the sneaker, tugged at Claire's ankle, and finally freed her foot. Filled with relief, Laura swam up, flopped against the tree branch, holding onto it and resting, breathing in large gulps of air.
"I'm sorry," Claire whispered. "Are you all right, Laura?"
Nodding, Laura continued to rest for a minute or two. Then, reaching for Claire, she towed her back to the bank and dragged her up onto the grassy bank. Both girls were dripping wet and shaking with cold. Although Laura was exhausted, she wasted no time pulling on her jeans and sneakers swiftly. Supporting each other, they made their way back to the house. Once they reached the back door, which led into the kitchen, Laura stopped and stared at Claire intently.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.